Hello everyone and welcome back to Inuda's channel, or welcome if you're new here. My name is Julia and I am here today once again with Jan Madsen, the founder and CEO of Inuda. Jan, hello to you.
Hello to you, Julia, and thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you for being here. Actually, Jan, long time no talk. We haven't posted on our YouTube in a while because we've been pretty busy behind the scenes coming up with all sorts of new ideas and delivering to our fortunately increasing portfolio of clients, I would say, and having fun with that. And overall, just showing up every day, doing our best to deliver and have fun and just do a good job overall.
Yes. Right? As one does. Yeah.
As one does. So, people are going to see, let's not have that long of an intro, although that's not very that's not very usual with me. People are going to see in the title of this video that we have some sort of framework. And this is part of the new ideas that I was just talking about. So without further ado, let's give the people what they want and start with the question. What framework? What is this SCADA project framework that we claim to have?
Yeah, it's a tested and proven. Yeah, we call it a framework. You could call it all kinds of things. Some would call it a toolbox. I prefer the word framework because it kind of sets the frames around what you do. Right. But it's a tested and proven framework of things that will create an end-to-end SCADA solution for you. So essentially, it contains several things. It's a roadmap that will guide us through the process. It's a box of ready-made solutions that we can pick from and have things at hand when we build SCADA solutions. Right. So that's the framework we built.
Okay, so a roadmap and a few tools that we already have that we can use much easily.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so we have come up with this idea, but usually ideas are triggered by some sort of beliefs that one has, in this case, about the market, right? We must have seen something in the market that led to us or led to this apparent need of people for a framework, a SCADA project framework. What are these beliefs, or what's happening in the market that we felt like we needed this?
Yeah, it's not like we got some kind of a divine inspiration one night and lo and behold, the world cannot live without this. That's not the case. It's also not like I suddenly got inspired by something. The fact is that listening to many clients and talking with people, I just saw a pattern, and that's just how it is. And I think the key word here is overwhelming. So you want you need a SCADA system for some reason, and that can be different triggers behind that, but it appears overwhelming. You might even go down the motorway and have a look at Ignition as your platform to build it on. And then let's assume you get in contact with us. And one of the most frequent questions I get is, what is the best thing about Ignition? And I love answering that question because I say every time that it is that you can build almost everything on the Ignition platform that you need for your industrial environment. Right. And then, of course, smart kids and smart people in general, they do a follow-up question where they say, okay, got you there. So what is the worst thing about Ignition? And they say, well, it is that you can build almost everything. And then people start laughing, of course, because they understand the irony and the truth in it. In the fact, it's a fact that you can build almost everything, which is, on the one hand, liberating and frees you from proprietary solutions and whatnot. On the other hand, it is overwhelming because where do I start? So with all of that input, that's the why. Why did we build this? We created this because instead of just looking into an open void or a blank sheet of how to get started, we said, okay, so here's a framework with a roadmap and some think about it as building blocks or Lego bricks, if you like, to get started.
Yeah, that's a good analogy with the Lego. So from what I'm understanding is there are two ideas here. One, don't start from scratch, and reduce overwhelm in a world full of options, because there's so much that you can do, but you don't even know where to get started. And I actually have a bit of a recent story about that. Bettina and I, for those of you who don't know, Bettina is the co-founder of Enuda and Jan's wife. And we were talking yesterday, I think we had a call, and we were thinking about making some changes to the website, right? And for that, we need a web designer. And during the call, Bettina and I were trying to come up with the exact details and the requirements that we may need from a web designer for the layout of the page and the design and the color palette and all of that. So we can give all of that to the designer and they just execute, right? But the problem is that Bettina and I were not experts in any of that. So whatever we had, it was probably not enough for a quote unquote beautiful website. And Bettina at some point figured this out, like realized right there on the call. And she said, wait a second, why are we doing this? We don't even know where to start. Like we have some, we have some ideas of what we want, but what would be super cool was to find a web designer that can also be kind of like a consultant and that can take our messy ideas and put them in a good structure using their expertise. Because the truth is, we don't even know what we want because we don't have enough knowledge to think that far. And I think, and I believe this is what we're trying to do with our clients, right? It's nothing revolutionary, like you said. It's not divine inspiration. We didn't bring necessarily a new idea to the market. We're just trying to put messy thoughts in a more organized structure and say, hey,
absolutely,
yes. Your project is, of course, unique, like a website is unique to us, but we have some principles and some steps that we gathered from our experience and from our expertise with this project and say, hey, we got you. We hear you. We see your unique requirements. But we know how to recommend an optimal or the best course of action in your case.
Yeah, it ties back to an idea. I think the origin, you can trace it back to Dan Pink, the American writer, who says something about that if you go back some decades, the value was in being the problem solver. But nowadays, the real value is in being the problem finder. And if you can quantify and qualify the problem, then it's easy to find the problem solver. And that's what you're talking about here, right? The idea of a blank sheet or blank slate, if you like, is just overwhelming. The key word here is overwhelming. Absolutely. Where do I start? And that's why your story there, or the analogy with the web design, that's just wonderful. It would be wonderful, wouldn't it, if you had a professional web designer who came into our life and said, here's a roadmap. We have to go through these steps. There are 17 steps in my roadmap. We do not necessarily have to go through all of them. We'll have a look at that. But there's a roadmap, and we can just go through them, and I'll ask you some questions, and we'll talk you through it, and I'll tell you how to do this, and blah, blah, blah. Then we're done.
Absolutely.
But it feels, I'm not sitting here feeling like an idiot, because, hey, there's a roadmap, right? And none of us like to feel like idiots. The opposite approach to this is to come in and say, hey, I'm an ignition integrator. I have here's my notebook. I have a blank sheet of paper, and I even brought my pen. dear client, what do you want? Right? That's a bit intimidating, because they would say, I want a SCADA system, right?
Yeah.
Cool. SCADA, tell me what you want. How should your SCADA? Yeah, how should they know? They don't know, because they have no idea what are the limitations, what are the opportunities, what. So the one of the most frequent follow-up questions we get is this: what do others do?
Absolutely.
What is your experience from how do others deal with this?
Right.
And then that's how the idea of the framework actually came up, saying, hey, what do others do? Let's try to turn that into a modus operandi, if you like. And that ended up as our framework and roadmap and whatnot. So based on experience and just have a framework to work from.
Yeah.
That's the idea of what we did. We do not claim to have the solution for SCADA. We claim to have a solution. We have a framework, a roadmap. And if nothing else, it's a cool way of talking your way through a process and say to the client, this is what would normally happen. And then they would say, that part over there, we certainly don't need that. Oh, that part over there, that's one of the biggies in our organization, and so on. So you have something, you have like also a roadmap for discussions and also also something that is appreciated. Something I realized recently in a I participated in a physical meeting in Norway where they, so we went through the roadmap and then they were sitting there saying, okay, we have a little bit of work ahead of us. So it's also a way to quantify and qualify the magnitude of what you're dealing with here.
Absolutely. So you just talked about how this framework is actually customizable to the clients. Like you just mentioned that the client may say that, oh, this doesn't work particularly in our case, or we do need that. But we claim that there are some general principles and some general steps that do apply to most projects, and that we want to be guided by. How does this framework work regarding that?
Yeah, okay. So I think there's one thing we need to get on the table right up there in front. So in the good old days, and they were not good, but that's how we put it, back in the day, engineers would spend countless hours on specifying everything. So making the specs for a huge project could take anything from half a year to 1 year, and then you would have everything. That's it's also called the waterfall model, and so on and so forth. And you would specify everything up front, and then you would find somebody to implement that.
Right.
The problem here now is we need to work in an agile way, because in most cases, we don't know exactly what is needed. And it makes little sense to put an unlimited number of hours into specifying things and making very long technical specifications and engineering documents, simply because before you've done that, your business requirements have somehow changed.
Right.
That's just the world we live in. So what we saw was, you need it's a different approach to things. You need an agile mindset where you accept that things will change in the process. Hence, you also need a platform to build it on that is flexible and versatile. And I'm happy to report that is the case with Ignition. That's why we use Ignition for this. Nevertheless, there are some things that we just see time and again. And one of them, what you have here as number one, is that in most cases that the client wants to see some kind of proof of concept. They might even have chosen two or three or maybe four different platform or software solutions that they are testing in parallel. We have seen that several times. So you need some kind of proof of concept. At least in the proof of concept, what we write here underneath the box here, connect and get data. So the fact that you can connect and get data, that is just something we see time and again. And therefore, we have built in some natural steps in our framework on how to do that. We have some standard solutions on that. Step number two is to get access to data in one place. That's the unified namespace that everybody and their grandmother talks about right now. And it's just so fun, right? We don't have to go that far back in time, and nobody knew what it was. Now it's just like the new thing. So the unified namespace, and that's part of the architecture and the system that you built upon which you can build your SCADA solution. And we have made standard solutions for that based on Ignition.
Right.
And SCADA and MES solutions, there's an overlap, at least there's a gray area between the two today.
Yeah.
And we have made some standard solutions for different things. There are anything from faceplates in the standard faceplates in SCADA solutions to dashboard solutions for OEE or what it might be, downtime solutions. Have those, just pull them directly out of your toolbox and say, nah, here it is, and ready to implement. And we have some roadmap for how we roll out things, how we work with the change management, how we do product management, how we transfer of knowledge from our organization to the client's organization. So that's the things that we see every time, and they will of course vary from client to client, but we see these four steps every time. Hence the roadmap.
Yeah, makes sense. So first step is show value with something, show and tell, kind of under the radar, just to convince a few stakeholders that, hey, this is actually useful and cool. And then get data from all the different sources to one place, then use that data actually for something, which is the SCADA or MES functionality, and then make sure the rollout of all of that is successful.
Yes.
These are broad steps, of course, but in our experience and from what we've seen in our clients, even if these are broad, it is still a relief to see them and to have them, because they are not at a super advanced level or anything like that. They just need a guiding light, and this is what this
Correct.
Is.
Correct. And not to forget, when we talk about each of these four, one of the questions we get all the time is, how do others do this, right? Mm. So they just ask that, how do others deal with this? And then we talk about that. We are, of course, not at liberty to talk about specific clients or specific solutions, but we can talk about, in general terms, our clients do like this and that.
Right.
So it we can use this roadmap also to instigate some cool discussions with potential clients about how to deal with each of these problem areas, if you like.
Yeah, absolutely. And we see here in this infographic, we will have a video about it, so we don't have to go into too much detail. But what is that little template thingy there?
The little template thingy there it's a closed box, right? Which means it's a secret, right? That has to be like that. So you're just curious to open the box. What we've done is we say, okay, so if you use standards or internationally recognized standards, like for example the ISA 101, which is the high performance HMI standard, then there are some standards on how you build things from the HMI perspective. That's the front end of things. And if you then at the same time use the ideas of ISO 95 and the unified namespace and so on, then you kind of know also how you want to build things in the back end. So you have your tag structure and how you want to organize things. So we have built standard solutions, templates, if you like, both in the back end and in the front end, so that we can pull them out. We can actually open that box and pull them out and have something to have working very fast.
Yeah, absolutely. And even if or when we do need to customize them, we still don't start from scratch. It's not like you, like a client is paying us to build an entirely new solution, and we can deliver faster.
Correct.
It will be cheaper for the client. It's just we will work faster for ourselves, right? It's also a win for us. So it's a win-win for us and the client.
Yeah.
Okay, so what we just talked about was a bit more on the tech side, but let's see, how do we actually navigate a project, or what is that roadmap that we mentioned?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think the easiest way to explain that is to take an example. I can take an example from this week, actually. There's so much focus on the tech side here. We tend to forget. So the overarching title of what we're doing here, that is digital transformation. There's so much talk about digital transformation, and then there's so much underneath that, there's so much focus on the tech part. We tend to forget that all of this is actually about human beings, and it's about changing some behavior. So digital transformation is less about technology and more about changing behavior in the organization or changing some processes.
Right.
And what we have learned is that there's a lot of understanding of that or change management going into these projects. All right. So here is an example from this week. I had multiple calls with them this week, and it is a global organization, multiple sites, and that's the discovery phase there. They just have the same problems that like everybody else. We're trying to get things connected. We have legacy equipment. How do we do that? We understand the concept of a unified namespace. We see the value in all of this. How do we get started?
Right.
And I have shown some of the template things that we have. I've shown the demo that we use, the SCADA by Nuda demo that we use, and they see the value in that and say, this is pretty cool, and it's built according to standards like we talked about previously. And we talk about the business case, I have agreed to help with input on the business case. What does it take? What is the how low can you go? Some call it minimum viable product, whatever. I just call it how low can you go? How low can we go in actually proving the value on this? So how do we get started and prove the value?
Right.
We talk about scalable architecture. Sure, we want to get started, but we also want to get started in a way that we are not locked in to something that is just working here over in the corner. We need something that's scalable. If it actually works, which we assume it will, how can we scale it? Then the management part here, as you have here, is point number five. We need somehow to get that. We need to get buy-in from not only management but from everybody. And here the roadmap plays a role, because you can internally, these guys can carry this around, whether it's to management or it's to the operators on the plant floor, whatever it is, and say, this is what we're going to do. There's a plan. We have a plan. Yeah. And that is very much appreciated, that it's not like, we have no idea. We hope this is going to work. No, there's a plan, right? And we know there will be deviations from the plan, but there is a plan. Mm-hmm. And your point six here, the ongoing support, that is what we do all the time. We do training of people on the client side. You do that yourself. For some of our clients, you handle the internal communication. We participate and contribute to the change management. We bring ideas from one client to another when we can, and say, no, we have learned that it's a good idea to do like this and that, because it actually makes it easier for you guys to get buy-in from operators or whatever it might be.
Yeah, so
we do this all the time. So that is how we do it. Try to get to something tangible as soon as possible. Something to show. That is something that is very important to me, because on the one hand, engineers, they love to work with the architecture and the unified namespace and the databases and the data flow and all of that, all of which it's important stuff. Of course it is. And it must be flexible and scalable and all of that. The problem is, guys, you don't have anything to show for yourself.
Mm.
So people will look at you and say, hey, you guys, hey, oi, oi, in there. You've been sitting in that dark room for 3 months now, and you said you do something valuable. Show me the money. Where can I see something? We don't have anything to see, because we've been working on the architecture and the unified namespace and all the cool stuff. Oi, I want to see something, right? So you need to have both tracks. You need to do your scalable architecture and do your unified namespace and all of that, get things connected. But you also need to remember to build something small, so you have something to show for yourself.
Absolutely.
Show something that is valuable. Oh, people say, okay, I understand it. You have this dashboard with something that's actually valuable, and I understand that this is just something small, and I understand the concept of scalability and whatnot, but there's something to show. So that's how we work. That's how we do it.
Of course, and it makes total sense, right? I mean, the architecture and the unified namespace and all of that is all cool for an engineer probably, but it's not like they work alone. They have all these other people to convince, especially if you're at the beginning of the project. You are going to want to ask for a budget, and no one is going to give you money because you want to build a unified namespace that they don't understand.
Yeah, and then engineer will say, yeah, but then we have single source of truth and all the other buzzwords. Hey, single source of truth, which is, I agree, super valuable. And the operator will say, hey, can I just have something where I can see how it's going, right?
Yeah.
I don't really care. That's your problem, right?
So, absolutely.
So that's part of this this approach. You need to somehow facilitate everybody around it. There are many stakeholders in a project like this, and have something to show for yourself as soon as possible and as fast as possible.
Absolutely. I think the main takeaway here is that we're not just tech people, we're also business people and project managers, and we can also support with the communication to not forget the human aspect of it all. The operators and the other stakeholders, you need to speak their language. And engineers often forget that in the coolness and the enthusiasm of these cool tech solutions they can have. So we come in and say, hey, let's see how we empower the operators to actually use your cool solution.
And that's why this is why I normally say that it took me 5 years to get my master's degree in engineering, and then after that it took me 10 years to get normal again. So that is what it's all about, right? So we should not forget that digital transformation is about human beings and business processes, which is ultimately also about human beings. But it is more about that and less about tech. And thus we need to work in two ways. We need to work on all the tech stuff and so on in the background, and then we need to remember to have something to show to get some fans, some people who will be enthusiastic about what we do, who will push us to say, yeah, you showed me this cool customizable dashboard last week. Yeah, nothing wrong with that, but it was hey, I need more of that stuff. Hmm. Go get something. Do something, right?
Yeah.
And so it's all about this push pull thing. We we love to push things, but it's actually better if you can get the users to pull for it, say, hey, get going, do something.
Yeah, shows interest.
Extend my dashboard. I can look into my dashboard, but I can only see one value. Hey, give me the rest now.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's also the satisfaction to see that, okay, the solution is cool, but look, it's actually doing something for people. Like the operators are actually getting some use out of it. And
yes.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yes, that's cool. It's very satisfactory to work with stuff like that.
Right. You know what? I love that idea. My suggestion is that we end there with that takeaway. So yeah, everyone, this is the SCADA Project Framework in its current version with our current understanding. We learn every day. It's gonna get better. It's gonna change probably. But this is who we are and what we do and how we do it today. So
yes, it is.
Thank you very much, Jan, for this.
Thank you.
And thank you to all of you who watched this. See you next time.